I know I had some feedback when my session proposal went up on the site. Some people got in touch with me and said, so is this like an English language session? And it goes, hey, strange word, nice word. I know, I suspect some people sitting here will be more curious about the word polymath than anything else. And I also know there are some people who abhor the word math. I do as well.
Yeah.
Which means those are some of the people who've headed off to space 2 or space 3 because they thought it's something to do with math that we're talking about. No, it isn't. Not at all. Okay. I can see maybe 3-4 people who know me, who've interacted with me heavily over the last 4 or 5 years. Not counting my wife, of course. And I can see a few others who I've kind of briefly met at various places over the last few years. So, have we met before? I don't really need a show of hands, but, I can see that some of you have met me before. Most of the people who've met me before or who have Googled my name or who interacted with me at any level know of me as a photographer. Many of you have attended exhibitions by me at Jahangir Art Gallery or at the NCPA, India Habitat Center, Delhi, other places, etc., or have read articles about my exhibitions, about my works in practically every English newspaper in India has at some time or the other done a half page or a full page on me or more. So that's the profile, that's the portfolio people think of as me. There's another lot of people, and I can see only one person, I think, in this group who's aware of that, but there are many others outside, who only know of me in the context of electronics design, in electronics design consulting, be it in the industrial space and so on. And to those people, I don't talk about photography at all. Okay? And this is the unfortunate reality of today, which we'll touch upon in this session, that those people know me as some kind of an electronics guy. If you go to, if you Google any electronics design question and you know, I think 3 times out of 10 questions would be answered. There would be Anindo Ghosh as one of the people answering them on various sites on the internet. Other people, at least one gentleman here and some others, know me only in the invention, industrial design, engineering, consulting space, and electronics might be a little bit of it, but yeah, photography, not really, right? There are a couple of other things I do. I'm also a member of the Film Writers Association of India. I just sold my first script recently. I'm the script I sold is not that one. The script I sold is a different one, which probably later today in the evening, I'll probably do a reading of a few scenes from that script for anybody who's interested around dinner time. Anyway, so there are a bunch of different things I do, some of which some of you know about, some of which some of you might want to be doing or might already do as well. So let's jump into it. Let's start very simple. Photography, I'm willing to bet that at least 50% of the audience, I'd say maybe closer to 80% of this audience here are either photographers or want to be photographers or would someday like to, you know, take photography seriously. Is that correct?
No.
Do we have, 100%. All right. Okay, closer to 100%, sorry. So obviously that's a subject everybody understands. It's a subject which, at least at first glance, is simple enough to understand, so we keep it to that simplicity. There's creativity, vision, you know, the standard stuff which you talk about photography. There's some amount of technique and trickery involved, which is the first step moving out of photography as a skill into something slightly beyond. Now, the project which I'll take as an example, and I'll run through it very briefly, is one which I was assigned to do very recently, about 3-4 months ago. It was a documentation of an urban habitat which is undergoing extreme redesign. There's an area called Bhendi Bazaar in Mumbai. Entire area is about to be taken down, rebuilt into high rises, even there. So it's the center, it's the focus of the Bora community of India. It'll all be high rises about a year to 2 years from now. Their main mosque is going to get rebuilt. The entire habitat is going to change permanently. The people will remain the same, the habitat will not. So there was a need for documentation of the space. Part of the challenge of doing this project, I can't go. My wife told me I can't keep climbing up and down, so I'm just to defy her, I'm doing this.
This section is not about your wife. Please don't forget.
So, you know, the key point, and I'm not going to go into great detail about the specific images you're looking at. These are part of that project. It's a very small subsection of the overall documentation project I did. The point is, this entire project, this entire documentation effort had to be done with no tripod, with no use of flash, no photographs of women allowed, any of the women in the vicinity, so you know, one had to be very selective. No shutter sound within their mosque or prayer areas. The entire thing had to be done during a festival season because that is the best time to capture a habitat at its liveliest. So we had to do it during festivals. So obviously there were certain security concerns, stresses, etc. involved, as you can imagine. I stuck out like a sore thumb. I was probably one of the very few people who wasn't wearing a white cap or had a beard in that entire area. And I was carrying what looked like essentially a cannon. Right? It was a cannon, but a huge lens, so that makes it a cannon. I was carrying a couple of cameras, and I was very ably supported by the group which manages that area, so I didn't really come under significant threat, but it was interesting. The most important part, and you know, as we come along, you notice these are all night images. Most of them are night images. My specialization is night photography. My exhibitions have always been at least 50% night photography, and night photography without additional light. It's called available light photography. Right? So you'll notice that there's an entire spectrum of images I shot. Sorry, somebody is asking something. Okay. So the big challenges here were not the photography side of it. I'm sure many people with an excellent camera and maybe with a tripod, maybe with a very, very, high-end lens, etc., could get most of these images. The image that I'm going to kind of focus on in terms of moving away from photography as a skill is the last one in this set. Why hasn't that come up yet? So mind you, all of these were handheld. Just so you know, for those who have tried shooting in the dark, you can imagine the challenges. This one. So this image which you're looking at was shot handheld from the top of a building in very strong wind, no tripod, no extra light, of course, because I've seen people taking photographs of sunsets with a flash. And the standard question is, so what were you doing? Were you lighting up the sun? So something like this, obviously you do not even attempt to light up with a flash or anything else. So, key point being, an image like this truly illustrates where a photographer on a project needs to break away from thinking photography and start thinking disciplines other than photography. Such as, so at the very basic level, we've got an image, or we take four or five images, we see how they turn out, one of them works out well, we publish that one. Fantastic. Or we do something better. Somebody has worked out the mathematics for how to remove noise from an image. Not me. Somebody who's not a photographer, somebody who's a mathematician, people who are mathematicians have worked out how to eliminate or reduce noise at the cost of detail. So, we've got images. I could have not taken an image, noise reduced it, I would have lost the detail which I'll show you in a moment, and still have a good image. Not a great image, a good image. So if you look carefully, this area, the cars down there, you can actually see the detail of which cars' doors are open, what model cars they are, and so on if you see a large print. So there it's not photography alone that helped me, it's some mathematicians and their work that helped me. Also, there's some amount of physiology involved. I know how long I can handhold a camera to get a still image. Simple mathematics, 1 by the focal length in seconds. So if I'm shooting at 200 mm with a 200 mm lens, 1/200th of a second is the best I can handhold, expect to handle. And this kind of light, 1/200th mm would get me nothing useful. So what do? I could do the typical Facebook thing, boost up the saturation, get nice bright colors, lots of likes on Facebook. Fantastic. I could do the Instagram kind of thing. Hey, grayscale, fantastic. This is art. I mean, come on, every grayscale image is art, isn't it? I could do something slightly beyond the pale, futuristic, whatever, and I would still have an image. But none of these would have the detail that we're looking at here. The top left corner that you see is the image as any one of your best DSLRs will capture. And trust me, even if you didn't have a very good DSLR, if any of you are working with a point and shoot like the lady here is working with, you'd still get reasonably noisy, blurry, smudge in that area. The second area is noise reduction. Somebody has done the math. I've used the software which applies that math. And I've got the noise removed, but what I have is a blur. The third one takes into account all of the above and tricks on hand-holding, tricks on combining stacks of images to bring back the detail which was lost. So this image that you're looking at, originally it was 22 different images, handheld, shot in one burst, actually in two bursts, and then matched, stacked together, noise removed, etc. The level of detail is such that if you take a 2 feet by 3 feet print, you can see the tires of each of the cars in there. Right? And you saw how small that was compared to the original. So, one point of view, that's all just photography. My point of view, that's not just photography. If I were just a photographer, I wouldn't have got this. I had an opportunity to stand on the shoulders of giants, brilliant mathematicians who worked out noise reduction techniques, brilliant imaging specialists who worked out the techniques on image stacking, physiologists, people who understand human body and human behavior, to take their tricks. So it's not as though I invented any of the tricks that you saw used in this image or this entire project. But they're images which I combined. And if I actually had all those skills, my head would probably explode, right? For a typical photographer, a challenge like this is, hey, I need a tripod. How can I shoot this without a tripod? I'm not taking on this project. I need a big flash, a really huge flash to light up the entire Hindi Bazaar area, and so on and so forth. There's a whole bunch of different tricks, techniques. So I'll have somebody running around with popping flashes while I keep my lens open for like 5 minutes. Great, fantastic. Some people will just raise the ISO, get very noisy images and then blame their camera. Oh, I wish I had a better camera. Trust me, you could do a lot of this stuff with very, very basic cameras. You don't really need a better camera if you know some tricks. You have the standard Facebook and all of that, but then the multi-specialist, the person who goes beyond just photography, plays with balancing between ISO, aperture. These are standard ones which you learn in any photography course, but they also do things like, do not have coffee before the shoot. Why? Because if you have coffee, natural human physiology, your hand will shake more. You smoke, your hand will shake more. Have a meal at least half an hour before the shoot so that you're not hungry, you're not so starved that you cannot concentrate, that your eyes cannot focus, right? Or your hand cannot be steady. These are things which are not really photography. That's the second, coffee and the food is physiology, it's human physiology. There's noise reduction, mathematics, image stacking, which is optical tricks, fair enough. The advantage in pushing the edge of what's possible in any given field, any given field, the advantage for innovation goes to somebody who thinks beyond one or two or three sets of skills. So we're talking far beyond what you've learned in your college, what you do for your job, and so on. There's a mix of skills which go into a project like this. So, we have a project objective. We have the skills I talked about, the tools usage, the camera, photography, etc. But then also we have certain other skills which go into a mix in a project like this. And this is, we really started simple here. The end objective was one which I'm sure everybody in this audience considered perfectly feasible even before we had this discussion. What some of you may not have considered is that the limit of hand-holding, which some of you, those of you who formally studied photography know that one bifocal length is the maximum I can handhold. Some of you may not have considered that limit of hand-holding is not a photography thing at all, it's a human physiology. So all these skills go into achieving a result beyond the commonplace. So let's get down to definitions. Polymath. What is a polymath? Oh, the mic woke up. So a polymath is not a specialist, but they're not generalists either. We are, every one of you here at some point was a polymath, you just may not have realized it. We are multi-specialists. We are specialists in 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 different things. Most of us here, I know, are specialists in social engineering. We interact with people, we build relationships, we make friends, we get invited to events like this, we speak at such events, or we just sit and attend such events, we heckle the speaker, please feel free to do so, or we kind of nod while we are listening to something else entirely. That's all fine. That's all social engineering. It's a skill in itself. It's not, I'm sure none of you can say that your job description is social engineering. Fair enough? So let's look at it this way. What about somebody who does mathematics and who does physics, who does general engineering, mechanical, etc.? Is that automatically a polymath? Or a very popular term in magazines these days. So-and-so is a sports polymath. They do cricket, they do football, they do something else. Simple answer, no. A polymath is not limited to, you know, I know it's been debunked now, the left brain, right brain thing has been debunked, but let's just keep that for convenience. A polymath is not limited to the left brain or the right brain, as in the logical or the creative. A polymath is one who is evolved their skills and their interests into both spaces, and if possible into the physical as well, into the actually doing stuff, picking up 15 kilos of camera equipment and running miles and miles to get the shot. You know, just to go back to my earlier example. So polymaths basically are beyond just bi-specialists or tri-specialists. They're people who just refuse to limit themselves to any given set of skills. How many of you here are familiar with the name Leonardo da Vinci? Not Leonardo DiCaprio, not the actor. Okay. How many of you know enough about him to consider him an inspiration? I know this gentleman does because he spoke to me about it earlier, but yeah. So Leonardo is the perfect example of a polymath. If I were to just fill a list of the number of areas in which not only was he skilled, but he accomplished something which is held to regard even today, I'd spend the next 2 hours just making a list, and I'm not talking describing, I'm saying making a list. A painter, obviously, the Mona Lisa, the Vitruvian Man, the background of the slide, the Vitruvian Man is the image which Leonardo sketched, which went on to Voyager, the first ever man-made object to leave this solar system, right? That's printed on it. So this man was quite something. He was also an inventor, a botanist. He invented the helicopter, you know? He invented the bathyscape, which in modern terms is called a submarine. So, you know, there's no limit to the number of different things that man did. And you say, okay, so some of that might have been myths, some of that might have been his students doing stuff. Like the most well-known, or the only well-known Indian polymath is Emperor Ashok. He was supposedly a painter, a singer, a mathematician. And yet today, historians say that 99% of what is credited to Emperor Ashok was because his theory was, you develop something, achieve something, and I take the credit, and if you object, I kill you. Simple. You know, that's a good way of being a polymath. I wish it was that easy today. You know, just take credit and kill off the guy if he objects. Great. But, you know, in the real world, in well-documented facts, we have, you know, those of you who follow sports, who follow motorsports, Billy Arnold is a familiar name. 1930 Indianapolis 500 winner. He came in out of nowhere, and he was like one of the most amazingly skilled, as they call it, technical race drivers, right? 1930 was the first Indianapolis 500 race which was totally run by technique as opposed to by inspired skill or luck or whatever else, and that's one of the things he's famous for. He went on to do a BTEC or BE in mechanical engineering from MIT, then a PhD in the mechanical engineering space, went on to fight in World War II in the Air Force, retired from the Air Force as a one-star general. What is probably more interesting is he also invented the water ski and the sport of water skiing. He spent his last few years selling cars as a car salesman because he just wanted to, not because he needed the money, because he wanted to. Somebody bought him a car showroom and he started selling cars. And he did some architecture work, some construction, etc. So he's, most people know him only as a race car driver, a lot more. This one probably is a bigger surprise if any of you are into old English movies or old European movies. Hedy Lamarr, very famous actress. Also, yeah, I know, I can see the surprise on some faces. Curtsy, the associations she had with various scientists that her husband of the time was a patron to, she ended up being a very well-regarded, published, peer-reviewed scientist and an inventor of something we all use every day today, surprising as it may sound. She invented or co-invented and holds the patent to the technology. Yeah, cell phones and Wi-Fi. Okay, the spread spectrum technology is patented by Hedy Lamarr, is actually invented by Hedy Lamarr. And the funny thing was, the technology was offered up to the US Department of Defense, the Navy, for use, and for 20 years they refused to use it. The day the patent expired, Navy ships in the US started using it. And then, of course, the patent got bought by a Canadian company, which now gave us Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi uses this as one of the core elements. So interesting, these are all people we've heard about. Some of them we knew are polymaths, but some of them, it comes as a surprise. I could see the surprise in some cases. So how about polymaths you all know yourselves, right?
Buckminster Fuller,
do you know him? No, let's talk about people you know. I mean, you know, that was pleasant surprise, like, all right. How many of you personally know a polymath? And if I'm seeing only a small percentage, then I think you guys are not really thinking. Every 5-year-old is a polymath. Yeah, I can see the surprise. Yeah. Think about it. Every 4-year-old or 5-year-old you know wants to sing, they want to dance, they want to paint, they're learning how to tell time, they know when mama is going to look in on them if they're quiet for too long, right? They're learning social engineering, how to give just the right cheeky grin to get away with anything. They have started learning the alphabet, words, language, grammar, at least to an extent. Some of them actually retain that lisp in their way of speaking because it gets them brownie points. Right? Think about it. Every 5-year-old is truly left brain and right brain, is truly multi-skilled. And then something happens. Right? Something we do to them. Those of you who are parents with, say, 3-year-old, 4-year-olds, 5-year-olds, I'm sure there must be some. I'm sure you encourage your kids to go to painting school or to go for music classes and all of that, which is fantastic. You're basically getting your kids to think and develop in multiple different directions. Awesome. Just don't let that stop. Do not destroy the polymath you have in your homes. Right? Some of us didn't have that chance, whatever. But some of us did. You know, there's always that person. Like, you know, I noticed 4 or 5 people raised their hands confidently when I said, do you know a polymath? So those are the people you know who are, you know, that guy who has the answer for everything. The guy you turn to not for a specific solution to a specific problem, but when you don't even have a clue which way to look for a solution to a problem. When you don't even know whether this given problem you're trying to solve is electrical, mechanical, engineering, just bad thinking, mathematics, whatever else. You always talk to this one person who either says, okay, here's what you seem to be doing wrong, or who says, let me Google that for you. So Google is a great polymath. And those who can use it, Google effectively are, you know, learner polymaths or proxy polymaths. Fantastic. But then everyone over here is also a polymath. If you can break past the, you know, the social conditioning, the whole, you know, you shall do this. Some of you are saying, no, I've never had social conditioning. I've had the luxury of doing whatever I wanted since I was a kid. You know? Some of you I can see nodding. Some of you are obviously saying, no, yeah, I agree. Fair enough. So let's break it down. Let's look at where we went off track, where some of us went off track. And I'll admit that I know some people here who do enough other things that they qualify very much for having not gone off track. So we have that 5-year-old child who, you know, don't worry about reading the text. It's not important. It's just a visualization that there's a left side and the right side to my story. Okay? So don't worry about that. So we start with this child who is, as we've agreed or concluded, a polymath. You start looking at them as they're these good students, the people who follow what the kindergarten teacher told them to do. They do their A to Z correctly. They know how to do 4 plus 4 and they know how to do 6 plus 7, which is awesome. They do all their homework on time. They misbehave a little bit, every kid does. And then there are others where you have the weekly PTA meeting where you have to go in and explain to the teachers why the child is so unfocused. You're not treating the child right at home. You're not giving them the right kind of encouragement. Encouragement? Excuse me. You're not teaching the kids to only follow what the teacher said. That's why the teacher's upset. So which side would you rather be? You'd rather keep the teachers happy. Otherwise, you'd be spending a lot of time dealing with them. So we start biasing ourselves towards what is on the
left side of the screen. I'm very bad with left and right, don't mind that. I'm slightly autistic. Left, right, I cannot understand. I cannot remember names of people or places. It's taken me many years to remember that my wife's name is Namisha. Sometimes at awkward moments, other names do come out. We shall discuss that offline. Anyway, so we start. So we've got the left side and the right side, right? Let's assume that I've got the left, right, and the right side. As you go beyond school, those students who are all the bright students, good students, the neighbors say, "Arey, ye to engineer banega." This one's definitely going to be a doctor, not just a doctor. This one is going to be a gastroenterologist. This one's going to be a gastroenterologist for women. Talk about extreme specialization, right? And then there are those people who are like, "Oh, this person is like kind of very scattered, jack of all trades, master of none." I know, people who come to an event like this, I'm willing to bet that 80% of you fall into the right side bracket, where throughout your lives, your parents have wondered, what is this person going to do? You know, is there a career path for this person? Total career crisis, right? That's why you're sitting here. I mean, come on, this is a Friday, it's a working day. Why aren't you at your jobs? You have jobs. I don't. Right. So the breakup very quickly becomes the broken polymath and the made polymath. Where does that get really exciting? When you have somebody like the gentleman who was here before me, you know, who says at age 16 he climbed Everest? At age 20 he just might, you know, write a new thesis on something and get a PhD, or, you know, could do something extreme because the parents are willing to encourage it. Every one of you is capable of creating such polymaths. Every one of you, and here's the interesting part, every one of you is also frustrated with whatever you're doing today. I refuse to believe there's anybody here who doesn't think they can do something more, or they want to do something more. How many of you have started learning music late in life? Okay, some. How many of you have gotten into photography late in life? Some. I started at age 8, which was very late in life. My dad is an award-winning photographer, you know, since before I was born. So, as far as my dad's concerned, I'm like, I started late in life. But anyway, when you started something of your own volition, not because of parental beatings, of your own volition late in life, think about it. That basically implies whatever else you were doing was not keeping your mind completely satisfied. What was happening at this very light gray thing, which you were not expected to read, but which I'll just tell you anyway, is your mind started stagnating and calcifying, and you're like, I need to do something else or I will die. I might live to another, you know, to an age of 100, but in my mind I will die. That's a problem, and the solution is to do some more, to break over to the adventurer mold, to start climbing mountains, or at least till base camp. Let's not kill too many of us this week. To actually push beyond, become photographers. Why is it that every alternate person I meet is a photographer? Because they're frustrated with whatever else they were doing. And photography is a great way of expanding your mind. So why not? Right? Music, you know, one person I consider a mentor is a polymath. At age 65, he decided he's going to start learning Carnatic vocal. And he's already given performances. He's considered to be reasonably good after about 5 years. Why? He was frustrated doing his technology stuff and whatever, and he wanted to do something else. And where did I meet him? He came to teach me C++ when I was doing my master's. And in his first session, I told him, you know, C++ is a waste of time. It's a really poorly engineered language. He had a choice of taking me to the dean, which I was hoping for because I needed a few days off. Instead, he said, let's go to the canteen and you explain to me your position. You know, we're the greatest of friends even today. So, people even at age 60 or 70 can make that rainbow transition, can start becoming the adventurer, can start becoming the multi-skilled person who enjoys every moment and wishes that there were just another 24 hours per day. I mean, I could do with another 15 hours per day, but let's say 24. Point in example, this is a picture from Goa. Okay, by the way, all the images that you see here, except the images of the famous polymaths, are images I've shot over time, so it's all my content. These two people, Maren and Ramsey. Maren is the one at the back, lady. Front, Ramsey. Ramsey is an air traffic controller who's also a brilliant fire juggler. Imagine, air traffic controller, hardcore mathematics, high stress job. And then he takes 3 months off every day to come to Goa and fire juggle. Maren, I'm not quite clear what she does, but she teaches something in the technology space, in the mathematical engineering space, and also the fire jungle. They kind of, you know, they chose to go beyond doing one-sided things. So there are choices which people made. I intentionally skipped over a little video clip which I had over there because the audio is not figured out. So revisit your choices. Key point, revisit your choices. Open the closed issues. You know, at some point in my life, I wanted to be a painter. But parents told me I'm not going to make money on it. So, you know, I'm going to be a starving artist. Jhola party. So I didn't want to be that. I closed those choices. Reopen those issues. There is this famous Google 20% rule. Every one of you can have a 20% rule. I know Google doesn't follow it anymore, but there's no reason you cannot set aside 20% of your life to do something a little extra, right? Whatever that might be. And something vastly different from what your day job is. Set challenges. Don't just say, I'm going to spend 20% of my time watching cricket. Come on, India spends 90% of their time watching cricket. What's the additional 20% going to get you? 110% time? Not workable. Think about something which sets challenges for yourself, make it happen, right? There's a challenge which I set for myself about 7-8 months ago, which was a mobility device for the blind. Something like what you see I'm holding in my hand. This is just a PowerPoint remote presenter. Something like this, which would be an add-on to the white stick for the blind, but which could also be used by the deaf, which would give something more than the white stick does. Like what? I should be able to sense things which are more than one. A white stick is typically 1 meter tall, 1 meter long, more than 1 meter away, say 3 meters away. Not a very crazy expectation, but say 3 meters away. I would like to know if a bus is coming towards me from 10 meters away. A blind person can still hear the bus, a deaf blind person cannot. Right? So the challenge was this. There has to be something more. Interestingly, you'll find that if you do a little bit of research, there are a couple of products which do some of these things. Not affordable typically in an Indian scenario. I mean, the lowest price such product I know of is $1,500 US, plus taxes and import, etc. I mean, how many of you would be able to buy something like that as a gift to someone you know who's blind or deafblind? Zero? Maybe a few. Whoever's Jaguar is standing out there, probably. Yeah, I've been drooling over the blue Jaguar. What if I could do something like this? What if we could do something like this for as little as $100 a piece? You know, 5,000 rupees. It would be good. What would I need to do it? I would need a concept. What's the concept? I need to have some light going out or some signal going out, read back a reflection, and therefore sense what's nearby. Feed that back to the user, the deaf-blind person. Now, the person is deaf and blind, so giving them beeps is not going to help. Giving them an LED indication, ridiculous idea. But how many of you have mobile phones? Everybody?
Vibration.
Yeah, exactly. How many of you have tried the vibration mode on your mobile? SMS has a different vibration. Your ringtone has a different vibration. And you can in some phones, you can actually set hundreds of different vibration patterns depending on what you're trying to do. So let's talk about the optics, obviously. Electronics, software, production logistics. Put all these skills together. So this is the same concept as we did with photography. Put all these skills together and what do you have? You have a product which is just going into crowdfunding called Wayfinder. The concept is mine, the design is mine, the optics are mine, the electronics design is mine, the product design, the manufacturing, planning, the sourcing of equipment, the crowdfunding economics, how to get it crowdfunded, where, you know, if I ask people for $5,000, they'd hesitate. If I ask people for $100, and, you know, they'd still hesitate if they don't need it. If I say, give me $100 and I'll give this device to whoever you specify or a charity of your choice, suddenly you've got people lining up. So all of these skills, you know, go into making a non-contact safety device, which literally is going to look like a torch, right? Which you can use in addition to the white cane. We've got prototypes running. The prototypes are a little bulkier. You've got this lumps of circuitry all over. That's why I didn't want to show it here and embarrass myself. But the prototype is until we can go into mass manufacture where we can use miniaturized devices. More discreet than a white cane, just like a flashlight. Concept, not as I described. Beam goes out, beam comes back, gets measured, vibration. The computer-aided design for modeling the device, like I said, looks just like a torch, runs on pencil cells. We've got the CAD models in place, we've got them validated. How does this device really help us? We've achieved this, right? We're there. crowdfunding announcement will happen in the next month or so. You'll probably all hear about it in various ways. What does this give us that wasn't already there? A crowded city. This is Mumbai.
And probably fund it also if they see it.
Oh yeah. So I think the funding advice mostly comes from the wife, you know. Good job, business family and all of that. Me, I'm a Bengali. Don't understand money too well. Typical Bombay scene. A blind person has a challenge enough crossing this. A deaf-blind person, for them, this is absolute anathema. They can't get through this. With a device like we're talking about, they would actually be able to cross this, maybe not at peak hour, but you know, that image, that's not mine by the way, that image is from a TV series called Covert Affairs. One of the lead characters is blind, not deaf-blind, and has a little device which looks just like this, which he uses, Augie is the guy, he uses to sense. Now, our inspiration was that we checked with the various information available. Such a product does not exist, it's fictional. Now it does, right? Sitting here, we're talking about now such a product exists.
That's a good hand for that.
So, thanks. So, enhanced safety, extend, you know, all the things I talked about, that's what we achieved. And that is something which innovates beyond what the typical funder, financer, etc. think. You know, you go to a VC and you say, I want to make this device which will benefit maybe 100,000 or a million people all over the world. How many of those million people have money to pay for it? About 10%. Right, you know where the door is. Right? So you see the challenges of doing something like this. But today's concept of Kickstarter or Indiegogo, etc. allow you to break those barriers. What doesn't allow you to break those barriers is having at least one mind somewhere in your team who can think along those multiple lines at the same time. So I'm hoping that in the next 5 minutes, this group sitting here becomes people like that. Now I'd like you to look at, you know, the people next to you. I know some of you came as groups, so you know who each other are. But think about yourselves in the workplace. Think about yourselves in your day-to-day life, workplace, whatever. Standard question, what do you do? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? You know, I'm sure we've all been asked. And, you know, what are the answers you'll get? Oh, you know, I'm a lawyer, I specialize in criminal law or whatever else. You'll find all kinds of things. And you'll find, you know, somebody says, I'm a secret agent. Oh, fantastic. That's why it's hidden away up there in the corner. You know, and then there are some people who will say, I do many things. I'd like this group to become people who do many things. How does that work? A typical project, you've got requirements, you've got, and when I say project, it doesn't mean writing software or making a hardware device or whatever. A project, I don't know how many, any journalists here? A typical story that you write, you know, where you investigate, put a story together, make sure that the lawyers won't come after you and crucify you, make sure you won't get shot on your way home because of the story you wrote. All of that is a project. So every project has certain requirements, certain concepts, constraints, testing. Where does the testing come in? If I publish this under my own name, am I going to survive till I get home today? Probably not. So therefore, that's all part of it. All of these little blocks make up a project. And because these blocks are often at cross purposes with each other, because there are different specialists for each of these blocks, therefore there are band-aids holding these blocks together. That's every project any one of you has worked on. Think about it. You've got somebody who's a brilliant concept person, but that person doesn't have a clue how to fund that concept. Or doesn't realize that, oh, this concept is great, but the product, which, the parts which I'm planning to use for this concept don't even exist on the market. I only read about them in a scientific journal. Oh, fantastic. And now what? So you end up with a final output sometimes, which is stuck together with band-aids. Or you have somebody at the core who's a polymath who thinks multiple levels. That somebody then empowers individual people. And not just empowers as in make it so. You know, we're not talking Star Trek here. It's more like works with those people, saying, all right, you're going to take care of, you know, you think you're good at product design. Let's go ahead and help you make that product design. Here are the constraints you need to think about. That wayfinder device cannot be so heavy that a blind person can't carry it all day. Obvious, right? Should not be in a kind of case where I need to order 500,000 pieces of that case in order to make it viable. It should be something where I can buy some ready-made plastic torch body and use that to make this device. Then you get the product design guy to start executing that. you get somebody else to do the economics of it, somebody else to do the testing and so on. But all of them tying back, so you have a slightly smoother product. Yes, there are still, if you notice, it's still a band-aid putting the product together. Nobody ever gets a project done correctly, complete, one time around. It cannot happen. I mean, at least a non-trivial project. Can I toss a coin successfully? Yeah, I mean, there's a slight chance it'll land on edge, but otherwise, yeah, pretty much. But any non-trivial project, there'll always be band-aids. A polymath reduces the number of band-aids, makes possibilities, which you know, could not even think about. Next step, therefore, is why don't we just populate the entire, you know, let's say I have a company, I start, and I put 40 polymaths into it. Disaster! But one of the key things about every polymath is that they're interested in a lot of things. Good thing, right? But because they're interested in a lot of things, oh look, there's a rabbit there. They're going to go chasing after every rabbit on the way. So you need somebody to mentor them, to support them, to make sure they stay on track to what needs to be achieved. So what are we talking about? 40 project managers to manage 40 polymaths, and then 2 program managers to manage the project managers, and then the CFO just shooting himself in the head or herself in the head, because there's no way they can justify that kind of cost on productivity, which will not happen. Instead, what you need is some key people who, I mean, let's admit that they will be easily distracted and bored, but they will be able to work with other baby polymaths. So you hire people fresh out of college who've not been stagnated mentally. Put them as interns with your core polymath or polymaths. And you can actually make innovation happen. People are doing it. Google is doing it. Google has been doing it for the last 15 years. Right? I mean, some polymaths I've known since my college days today work at Google. And I mean, they shouldn't even be working there actually. They're 70 plus. But anyway, they work there. So, these are people who are being allowed to do innovative things, not being forced to do repetitive things. Maximum utilization of their skills. So every one of you who runs a business, this is worth thinking about. You don't need lots of polymaths, but some polymaths are nice to have. And that shouldn't be the one owning the business. Because then that polymath cannot be a polymath, has to focus on getting the funds in. Right? So like I said, I wanted this group to become like that. I realized that, you know, if wishes were horses and all of that. Let's try. Okay. How many of you have mobile phones which have never run out at an inconvenient time? The power, the batteries never run out at an inconvenient time. Can I see at least one show of hands? Okay, I think that makes it unanimous. Cell phone batteries will always run out at an inconvenient time. Why is that? Why can't we just have fantastic batteries which last forever? Why can we not have some kind of super nuclear energy thing in our hands? Maybe this group could make that happen. Let's kind of put the pieces together. My standard model. Study the problem. What is the problem? I need to put a certain amount of energy into my phone to be able to take it out. If I put too much energy into too small a place and something goes wrong, then instead of the cell phone explosion stories you read about where somebody's face got injured, you would read of cell phone explosion stories where somebody's town disappeared. Think about it. It's just a matter of how much energy you're packing into how little space. Think about the other parts of the problem. If I have to, you know, if my cell phone is 2600 milliwatt hour, you know, standard this thing, that means I need approximately 2 hours, let's say, with my standard charger to charge it, or 3 hours, or 4 hours, whatever the number. If instead I needed 50,000 milliwatt hours, or 500,000 milliwatt hours, would I be able to afford keeping my cell phone charging for 20 hours at a stretch? No. So again, that's a practical constraint. Study those problems and take a note of only the problem right on top, because that's the one I'm giving away as a freebie. The rest, you guys will talk about over the next 5 minutes and discuss with me. Yeah, so backup power is fine. That's one approach, right? No harm in adding that to the mix. Think about aesthetics as one of the problems. Like, come on, we're talking energy, we're talking engineering, we're talking electronics. How can we get more power out of our phones? How can we make our phones last longer? Aesthetics, why? How many of you used the original Motorola bricks when mobiles first came into this kind of heated? My phone was a half a kilo. My battery was nominally half a kilo. The rest of the phone was a few grams. And today, you know, on the way to here, I saw a hoarding, a huge hoarding by Lenovo. Lenovo has this ad saying, "My words have weight, my phone doesn't." Aesthetics drives battery power technology. It's not electronics, it's not chemistry, it's not product design of any other sort, it's not cost. It's aesthetics. It's, I want a thinner phone. I want a lighter phone. I want a phone that I could potentially wrap around my finger and wear like a ring. Wristwatch phone's not good enough. Aesthetics is driving this. There are other things, of course, technology, engineering, collaboration. Collaboration is what we're talking about here, all of that. But put all these pieces together. Let's just take a two-minute, and then I promise, and after that 2 minutes and we're done. Let's take 2 minutes, turn to the person next to you and ask them a very simple question. Ask them what skills they might have that could be applied to this problem. We're not going to solve the problem today. Okay? I'd really like to say, hey, listen, don't just look at me. Ask the person next to you, preferably somebody you don't know already, right? What skills they might have amongst these or others, which could be potentially useful in coming up with the next generation solution for cell phone batteries. Come on. Do I need to pass the mic, or do I need to bully people, or what? Uday, should I pass mics to
you? Go ahead.
All right, so... Okay, I'll ask the guy who made the mistake of talking to me first.
Drop testing and all the structural aspects of the battery I can do.
Oh, goody!
Good. We have someone here who has skills in breaking stuff. Fantastic. That's a good tip. It's good testing. What else? Okay. Let's say an
application. Well, I am a polymath. So the first thing that I was thinking about is, why do we want additional power? Basically, if the phone needs... Right. That's how I'm thinking, right? So what I'm thinking is, if the cell phone is not working, and if I want it to work, what would I need it for? Do I need it for internet? Do I need it for the phone? So if it's just for the phone, then probably can I just have this much battery power in reserve, just like your Razer. It's always stored. You can always make one last call.
Can I answer?
It's not just the answer. What he's touched upon, in two words, is usability engineering. The skill he's bringing to the table is usability engineering. Yep. Usability, what is most critical in an emergency, I need to make a call. Actually, not really. When I was coming here today, the thing I critically needed the phone for was Google Earth, Google Maps. I couldn't find this place. But yeah, fair point. So the skill we are talking about, he actually interpreted my question a little deeper than I'd expected or desired. The skill we are talking about is usability engineering. Well, what about you?
I think we both teamed up. We were having a similar talk. Mm-hmm. Concurrence, very fast concurrence. We were thinking the same lines. Why not code an algorithm? Every application, obviously smartphones require a lot of application.
So in two words, software engineering?
Absolutely. So algorithm detects the workload and then shifts down the resources that are not required and only empowers the
same data. Fantastic. Fantastic. So, software engineer, and I know I can see some software engineers here, so I know that that's something which...
With a big smile.
So even if it didn't actually make better energy utilization or whatever, you would sell it anyway by saying it looks prettier. Okay, good. So marketing, fair enough. No harm there. So you notice that there are skills people have here, some of whom I notice are applying skills that they use in their day-to-day life. I would assume marketing is what you do. Some of you are thinking beyond what they apply in day-to-day life. I'm not sure this gentleman here does usability engineering as a day-to-day job. You don't, right? So that is thinking like a polymath. This is what I am pointing at. Start thinking beyond what you anyway do, right? The opportunity for innovation is not in what you already have skills in, but it's between the cracks. Because think about it. We are talking about better energy efficient batteries, etc. Do you not think the best chemical companies have the best chemical engineers working on the best technology, brilliant people in voluminous quantities working on the electronics of more efficiently using the power? But the solutions might lie somewhere in the cracks. A chemical engineer is loath to think of an electronics person as even human. Trust me, I've faced it. My dad's a chemical engineer, I'm an electronics person. So they wouldn't really be talking to each other and saying, hey, you know what, let's solve part of this by chemistry and part of it by electronics. No, bollocks. Therefore, the polymath comes in and says, let's solve it in an entirely different way. Let's not worry about the problems which I know others are working on. Let's look at something different. And again, I'm sure others have thought of it that way also. I'm not saying that, he's got the perfect solution. But he is thinking like a polymath. When he started by saying, I'm a polymath, he has justified that statement. he's thinking beyond his job description. Those of you who are software people and said software is the solution, fantastic, that will be part of the solution. You're not thinking like what we are talking about here. You're not catching the cracks. Okay, so I'll end with essentially homework for those of you who are inspired enough to try and think beyond and start being innovators, achieving more than you have in your life. And I know many of you have achieved a lot in your life, but I'm sure there's always more. Allocate time daily plus weekly. When I say daily plus weekly, it could be 10 minutes per day plus an additional 2 hours per week. Or it could be an hour every evening plus an additional 4 hours a weekend. Whatever you can achieve. But make sure there are two parts to it, because it's very easy to slip on one part. It's very easy to say that this weekend we are all going to be here at the Goa Project. I can't put in my 5 hours for my, you know, polymath thinking, for my new skill. Once you've allocated the time, identify a mentor. It could be the five-year-old in your home. Think about it. You know, when that five-year-old is learning music, you could be learning music. You know, when that five-year-old is learning painting, you could be learning critical analysis of art. So it could be your mentor could be that five-year-old. But anyway, identify a mentor. If you can't find a local mentors are the best, right? But if you can't find a local mentor, you know, my Twitter ID is there, my email address is easy to Google up, my phone number is easy to Google up. I'm happy to kind of support to a reasonable extent, you know, unless you're offering good lunch. Learn a new skill. When I say new, if your work is in the creative side, marketing, arts, etc., think about something on the technology side, on the mathematical side, on the scientific side. If your work is software, okay, or other technology stuff, think about something entirely in the creative or instinctive side. Identify a skill, learn the skill, do this again twice or thrice. Once you've done this a few times, you get a feeling where I could now take on a project. Pick up the project, challenge yourself, build something, get that reviewed, come back to the beginning, and you've become a polymath. Thank you very much for, you know, sitting here for so long, actually. If there are any questions, either here or offline, I'm happy. No.